common person, you don't need much theology in order to be able to understand the Constitution and the Word of God. And if you haven't read it, you need to read it, because it's the foundational document for today's church. And if you need a hard copy, we can make one for you in the office. But it's also online. You can go to the Vatican's website, which is vatican.va. Very easy to remember. If you're taking notes, you can take notes, vatican.va. Or you can go to our own church's website. And the address of the church's website is on the front of the bulletin. Really easy, stjosephhom.org. But if you need the exact spelling, it's all on the front of the bulletin. So you take a bulletin home there in the back of the church. And then if you go on the church's website, there is a tab right at the top that says Bible Study. And the notes from the class and the documents are all posted there. So you can use that as a reference. And there you will find a link to the Constitution on Divine Word, on the Word of God of the Second Vatican Council, Dei Verbum. So let's begin with prayer today as we begin our Sunday scripture reflection on the following Sunday. So today is not yesterday's gospel, but on the following Sunday. Yesterday's greetings had to do with family, right? Had to deal with marriage and divorce. And the first reading was from the book of Genesis. We had notes yesterday. We had notes on yesterday's readings, and they were passed out last week. And if you missed last week's Bible study, don't worry, the notes and the video of the Bible study is on the church's website. The link to a YouTube video is there. So again, you just go to the website and then you'll be linked to the YouTube video and you can watch last week's Bible study. Before we begin this week's Bible study, I want to make a couple comments on last week's readings, because somebody brought this to my attention. And that is that the first reading we had yesterday, at yesterday's Mass, was from the book of Genesis that talked about the two becoming one, right? The man leaves his parents and is joined to his wife, and the two become one. That's very important for us to remember in today's day and age and in your family lives. It says there that two shall become one. That doesn't include the mother-in-law. It doesn't say the mother-in-law is joined to the two. And that not only goes for mother-in-laws, but that goes for all family members. Right? In other words, butt out, okay, of the marriage of your children. Don't try to run your kids' lives. Leave them alone. A lot of problems come when the mother tries to run the life of her child after the child has left the nest. Or other family members try to meddle in into the lives of a married couple. Stay out. And that also is a big lesson for married couples as well. Don't allow your other family members or friends to meddle in your own life. You married your husband, or you married your wife. The two became one. You've left your household behind, your old household, and you have established a new household. It's very important for the health of the family. May we pray today. We ask for the guidance of the Holy Spirit to take in the readings that we will be reflecting on for next weeks. Weekend, October 11th. Let us pray. May your grace, O Lord, we pray, at all times go before us and follow after, and make us always determined to carry out good works. Give us the grace, O Lord, to be doers of the word and not just hearers, to be people of mercy, kindness, and compassion. As we pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. So first, before we go into the readings, I would like to talk about the Constitution on Divine Revelation, the foundational document Dei Verbo, which you should have read. And the first point that I would like to touch upon made by this Constitution of the Second Vatican Council is that the Bible comes from the tradition of the Church. The Gospel was first part of the oral tradition of the Church. And so the Gospel, the Good News, as we know, the Gospel is not a book. It is someone, and that's Jesus Christ. He is the Gospel. He is the Good News. And preaching the Gospel means announcing Jesus Christ, the Good News of our salvation. It's Jesus who came and died for us that we might have life and have it in abundance. And so, first, the Gospel was preached orally. It was transmitted through word of mouth. The apostles preached the Gospel. It was not written down until later when the apostles saw the need to have a written account of the life of Jesus. Because in the early church, there was this idea, and if you read the Gospels, you will see this idea come through over and over again. If you read the letters of Paul, they had the idea that Jesus was going to come right away. The world was going to end, and that the second coming was imminent. In fact, many stopped working. That's why Paul chastises many people during his day, and he's saying, those who will not work shall not eat, because people even stopped working because they were waiting for the second coming of Jesus. And so while the Gospel was preached orally at first, the need to have it written down, as the people started seeing that the apostles were dying, those who witnessed the life of Jesus, those who heard it, they saw that they were dying and Jesus hadn't come back. They saw the need to have it written down. And so the oral tradition of the church was put into paper. They wrote it down. And that's where we have the Bible from. So before it was written down, it was preached orally by the apostles. These men then handed down to their successors what they learned, and it was handed on and on until they committed to paper what they first learned orally. This is why, as Catholics, we hold both scripture, sacred scripture, and tradition, sacred tradition, as sources of our faith on par. One is not more important than the other. Sacred scripture and sacred tradition go together. The Bible and tradition. Not just the Bible. This is a big difference. Remember, we're Catholics, right? This is the belief of the church. It's not just scripture. It's the tradition of the church as well. We hold both sacred scripture and sacred tradition as sources of our faith. Because before there was the Bible, we had tradition. The oral preaching. The tradition. Tradition came first. We therefore have to be faithful as Christians to both the tradition that is contained in the Bible, because remember, what is written in the Bible is tradition as well. It's the Word of God as transmitted through the apostles. It is the Word of God, it is the inspired Word of God, but it was first tradition. And so we therefore hold that we have to be faithful to both the tradition that is contained in the Bible and the tradition as handed down by the word of mouth through the centuries. So both sacred scripture and sacred tradition are to be accepted. The Second Vatican Council tells us they are to be accepted and venerated with the same sense of loyalty and reverence. Rejecting one is rejecting the other. So we do not believe in the Bible alone as our source of faith, because the Bible comes from tradition. Sacred tradition and sacred scripture, now I'm quoting here from De Verbo, the document that I have asked you to read. Sacred scripture and sacred tradition form one sacred deposit of the Word of God committed to the Church. And the task of authentically interpreting the Word of God, whether written or handed on, has been entrusted exclusively to the living teaching office of the Church, whose authority is exercised in the name of Jesus Christ. And so, in the Church, we have something that is called the magisterium, that is the teaching office of the Church. It's the bishops in union with the Pope. And it is their task to interpret for us the Word of God so that there isn't chaos. Because some people say, well, all I need is the Bible. Well, if all you need is the Bible, how come one church doesn't agree with the other? How come we have thousands, tens of thousands of denominations, and one denomination doesn't teach the same as the other? They can't agree. That's why the unity of the Church is so very important. And the unity of the Church is guaranteed by the teaching office of the Church, which is the Pope in union with the bishops, the magisterium. Remember, Jesus, before he died, prayed in the garden. Remember what he prayed? He said, Father, let them be one as you and I are one, so that the world may believe, so that the world may come to believe that you have sent me. But when the world sees division among Christians, it's no wonder that the world doesn't come to believe. That's why the unity is so very important. The number one job of our Holy Father, the Pope, is to guard the unity of the Church. The unity of the Church. That's why Jesus said, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. We believe those words to be given to our Holy Father, the Pope, who makes pronouncements, who teaches us, who interprets for us. That's the guarantor of the unity of the Church. So sacred scripture, sacred tradition, and the magisterium of the Church. Again, that is the teaching office of the Church. If you haven't heard that word before, write it down. It's there in the notes. The magisterium of the Church. They all stand together and are linked together in such a way that one cannot stand without the others. So you can't just have the Bible. And you can't just have tradition. The Bible, the tradition of the Church, and then the teaching office of the church to interpret those for us, to guide us. We need guidance. We need guidance. And all guidance comes under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. That's why in the Church we have seven sacraments, and one of those sacraments is holy orders. When bishops who are successors of apostles ordain priests or other bishops, right? And they pass on the apostolic succession to guarantee that the Holy Spirit works through these men who are ordained, through our bishops, through our priests. If any bishop, like Bishop Joseph Pepe, our bishop here in Las Vegas, if you look through his line, the succession line, it goes back all the way to the apostles. The bishop who ordained him was ordained by another bishop, who was ordained by another bishop. The succession of faith. And he enjoys the apostolic line. To pass on the apostolic faith, the faith of the apostles. The tradition. Hold on to your traditions that you have been taught by the apostles, the Bible proclaims, as we are taught. And so, the Bible, sacred scripture written under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, has God as its author. Obviously, the human beings who wrote down these inspired texts were human. But we believe that God used them, and the words that they wrote down were inspired by God. Men and women who wrote the books of the Bible were employed by God, who used them to write everything and only those things which he wanted. So, there is no error in the Bible. There is no error there. What we need is to interpret it the right way. But there is no error contained in the Bible. It is the Word of God. You either accept that or you don't. Don't let anybody confuse you by saying you can reject this or you can reject that. No. Everything is subject to interpretation. By who? The church. And we look to the church for guidance. Who interprets? The church interprets. She interprets the Bible for us. We today need to investigate and study the Bible to see what it is that God intended to communicate to us. That's why the church promotes scholarship, study of the Bible. We are to carefully investigate what meaning the sacred writers intended and what God wanted to manifest by means of their words. So it's not that there is something wrong that is written there in the Bible, or that there is error there. It's that it needs to be interpreted for us. Because remember, this was written 2,000 years ago. You can't look at it with the same eyes that you have today in 2015. That's why we have those in the church who study and who then present to us what it is that God intended to communicate to us. That is why we need the church to tell us what it is that God intended to transmit to us through a particular piece of the Bible. It is not enough to just have the Bible. You need the church. I can't emphasize that enough. If the Bible was all that you need, why is it that we have so many different churches which all interpret the Bible differently and one cannot agree with the other? You have to remember that the Bible was written at a different time and in a different place, with different cultural nuances. Now, the Second Vatican Council in its Constitution on the Word of God talks about the Old Testament, or the Hebrew Scriptures. God chose a people through whom he would enter into a special relationship with the whole human race. You know, the Bible is divided into two parts. You have the Old Testament and the New Testament. It's like if you go into a European city. You know, I'm from Europe, so if you go into a city in Poland, you will see that the city has a street that runs through it. On one side of the street is the old buildings, the older buildings, and on another side of the street you have the new buildings. But The new buildings look to the old buildings. And both have a street that runs through them. The street that runs between the old buildings and the new buildings for us is Jesus Christ. If you think about the Bible in that way, Jesus is that which connects the Old Testament and the New Testament. He connects both for us. One cannot be understood without the other. That's why the Bible is composed of the Hebrew scriptures, the experience of the Hebrew people who were awaiting their Savior, and the New Testament, the Christian scriptures, who accepted their Savior. And Jesus runs through the middle. God, through the people of Israel, whom we get to know in the Old Testament, made known His ways to all the nations. The books of the Old Testament are infinitely valuable, and in them we find God's marvelous plan for our salvation. That's why I don't like the name Old Testament, because some people will think, well, the new is more important than the old. No. They are just as valuable. The books of the Old Testament are also in the Bible. And we are to read them with great reverence. Christians, the Second Vatican Council tells us, should receive the books of the Old Testament with great reverence. For in them is given expression to a lively sense of God. That's where we get to know that there's one God. We get to know so much about the love of God for us. How much God loves His people. And that God does not wish any of His people to perish, but that He wishes to send them a Savior. Jesus Christ, whom we have received. So, the Old Testament contains a store of sublime teachings about God. They contain sound wisdom about human life. They contain a wonderful treasury of prayers. I think the most beautiful are the Psalms, which we hear every time we go to Mass. We have a song. How uplifting it is when we hear those beautiful words. So many people who are not even religious or Christian or Jewish, look to the Psalms for great inspiration, like the 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. People have that all over. Those beautiful prayers. And so, there is a great treasure in the Hebrew scriptures that we have to venerate in like manner as we venerate the New Testament. Both the Old Testament and the New Testament go together. The Christian scriptures, or as we know them, the New Testament. The New Testament begins with the Gospel of Matthew, if you open it. Why? Because it gives you a genealogy. Where did Jesus come from? Right? His lineage. That's where when you're beginning to read the Gospel of Matthew, you might get tired of all the names that are given you. Why are those names given there? Because the author of the Gospel of Matthew wants to show to his audience, he was writing for a Jewish community, that this is the Savior that comes from the line of David that you have been awaiting. And so he's so emphatic in order to show that Jesus comes from the line of King David. And He is the Savior that you have been awaiting. The Savior promised by the Old Testament to the Hebrew people and to all people. Because Jesus came for everyone. Jesus' blood was shed for all people. He came to save all people. But the Gospels, there you have Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. The Gospels, we are told by the Second Vatican Council, have a preeminence among all the scriptures. That is, they are the most important because they witness to the life and the teaching of Jesus. There is a preeminence that is given to the four Gospels. Reading the Gospels is getting to know Jesus, getting to know Him, developing a relationship with Him. You can't have a relationship with an it. You have a relationship with someone. And if you do not read the Gospels, you don't really have a relationship with Jesus. Jesus might be an acquaintance for you, like, you know, some people that you see here in the Bible study or that you see in church. You see them all the time. You know who they are. You may even know their names. But you don't really know them unless you spend time with them. Unless you make the effort to spend time with them, to get to know their story. It's the same with Jesus Christ. Unless we make the effort to get to know Him on a personal level, we will not have a truly meaningful and intimate relationship with Jesus Christ. It will just be an acquaintance that maybe I run into once in a while. I may know His name, I may know something about Him, as you know the names of many of the people here this morning, you may know something about them, but you really don't know them on a personal and intimate level. And that's why ignorance of Scripture is ignorance of Jesus. Jesus wishes to be our friend. He wants to be our friend. That's why we have to spend time with Him. If you don't spend time with your friends, you don't really know them. You got to spend time with them. That's why it's important to spend time with Jesus in prayer. And what better way to pray to get to know Jesus than using sacred Scripture? When we read the Scriptures, we are encouraged to do that in a mode of prayer. Doing it all in the spirit of prayer, that it's all prayer. The Gospels are of apostolic origin, which is something the church has always held. That means they come from the apostles, as I explained to you already what that means. What the apostles first preached and what was handed on from them was then, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, written down and handed down to us. And this is something that is extremely important. The sacred writers, the writers of the Gospels, selected from the many events of Christ's life, His sayings, His teachings, only some that they heard and put them down in writing. So we have only a limited selection of what Jesus did, said, and taught. And the Bible says that all the books in the world could not contain the life of Jesus. What He taught us, what He said, what He did. All the books in the world would not be enough to contain all that Jesus did. But these are written, the Bible says, that you may come to believe and have life through Him. That is why we have tradition that has been passed on from the beginning of the church that goes hand in hand with the Bible. Because the Bible doesn't contain it all. You can't just have the Bible. Because the Bible doesn't have everything about Jesus. The church possesses the great writings of the fathers of the church, the saints of the church, the traditions that teach us also valuable lessons to enrich our life, to enrich our walk with the Lord. They're just as important. So the church has always venerated the Bible just as she venerates the body of our Lord. The Second Vatican Council teaches us in that last paragraph of Dei Verbum, the Constitution on the Word of God. The Church at Mass feeds the faithful with the bread of life from both the Bible as well as Christ's body in Holy Communion. Jesus is referred to in the Bible as the Word. He is the Word that comes to feed us. He comes to feed us not just in His body and blood, but through His word as well. All the preaching of the church must be regulated by the Bible. The faithful should have easy access to the Bible. The church encourages this. All of us should have a Bible and should read it. The church has always worked hard to provide the Bible to the faithful. And some people will tell you lies that the church prevented people from reading the Bible. That is a lie. It's a historical lie. And they will point to that Bibles were in churches chained up. Well, they were chained up because there were very few books. Monks had to copy them hand by hand. You know how tedious that was? Books were very valuable. Of course they had them chained up because they didn't want them to be stolen because they were of great value. But the church has always promoted the reading of Holy Scripture. But people were illiterate, en masse, at that time, centuries ago. As much as the church promoted it, people couldn't read or write. Today we have a different age. We have books. We have great literacy, especially in our midst in the United States, and the church promotes the reading of the Bible, as she has always promoted. The church encourages biblical studies. All theology. Theology is the study of God. Ology, it's a Greek word, meaning study. It comes from study, the second part, and theo is the Greek word for God. So the study of God. Theos. The study of God. All theology rests on the written word of God. The Bible, along with tradition, are the foundations for all of theology. So you see how important the Bible is to the church? To the Catholic Church? Don't let anybody tell you otherwise. Just look at the Mass. How much it's all from the Bible. The study of the Bible is the soul of sacred theology. And the homily at Mass holds the foremost place as the way for God to nourish His people in a healthy and holy way. Clergy must make it their constant task to study the Bible and read it. Prayer should always accompany the reading of the Bible so that God and man may walk together. That's why we started here with the spirit of prayer, and our meeting every Monday is in that spirit, the spirit of prayer. Just as the life of the church is strengthened by the frequent celebration of the Holy Mass, so too is the life of the church strengthened when we give due reverence to the Bible, the Word of God, which lasts forever. The Mass is a gift from the Lord to all of us. And so is the Bible. It is a gift that God has given us. And so as we look at the readings for this coming week, we start with the Book of Wisdom, chapter 7, a reading from the Book of Wisdom. I prayed, and prudence was given me. I pleaded, and the spirit of wisdom came to me. I preferred her to scepter and throne, and deemed riches nothing in comparison with her. Nor did I liken any priceless gem to her, because all gold in view of her is a little sand, and before her silver is to be accounted mere. Beyond health and comeliness I loved her, and I chose to have her rather than the light, because the splendor of her never yields to sleep. Yet all good things together came to me in her company, and countless riches at her hands. The word of the Lord. The Book of Wisdom is one of the 46 books of the Old Testament. Here's another very important difference for us to remember. We are Catholics. We have a Catholic version of the Bible. It's important for us to have a Catholic Bible. If somebody's handing out Bibles, be careful, okay? There's no such thing as anything free, okay? You know that from your own life experience. Don't get suckered in by somebody giving you something and you think, oh, it's free, so I take it. You need a good copy of a Catholic Bible. A good Catholic Bible. Why? Because Protestant Bibles, and when I say Protestant, you know, the Catholic, the Christian world, we are Christians. I also hear that sometimes they people say, well, you are Catholics and we are Christians. We are the original Christians. And then they say, well, the word Catholic doesn't appear in the Bible. But the concept, the universal concept of the church does. From the early times, we know that the church was called Catholic. The followers of Jesus are called Christians. But the church Jesus established is called Catholic, a universal church for everyone. For everyone. With the Holy Father, the Pope, as the head of the church here on earth, the Vicar of Christ. And so, in a Catholic Bible, you will have 46 books. In a Protestant Bible, you won't have 46 books. And one of those books that isn't there is the Book of Wisdom. How come there's the difference in the Old Testament books and the New Testament books? Because there are concepts, there are beliefs, there are doctrines of the church that are universally rejected by Protestant Christianity, such as praying for the dead. You know, we do that, we pray for our dead. We have masses said for them, and that is contained, that belief is contained in the second book of Maccabees. Well, Protestants reject that. They don't pray for the dead. Protestants believe once you're dead, you either go to heaven or hell. We believe in the concept of mercy, that we have a God of second chances. That's why we believe in purgatory. Don't be so quick to reject the teachings of the church. Sometimes people say, well, you know, this or that teaching, does the church still believe that? Of course, we believe in purgatory, and it's a wonderful teaching. It's a merciful teaching that God doesn't want anyone to perish, anyone to be lost, but that God gives us second chances. And the concept of purgatory is present there in the second book of Maccabees. It's a wonderful belief. And Martin Luther, who was the, we could call him like the father of Protestantism. By the way, he was a priest. And so, and he was a member of the Augustinian order. And there were some really awful things going on in the church during his time. Awful things. And he protested. That's why, that's where you have the word Protestant from. He protested against the church during his time. And many of his original beliefs, his original thesis, the church has adopted now. But he kind of threw the baby out with the bathwater. He took it way too far. Way too far. One of those things is rejecting some of the books that we accept as inspired, as the inspired Word of God in the Old Testament, in the Hebrew Scriptures. Because they didn't coincide with some of the beliefs that he and others during his day wanted to promote, such as praying for the dead, which is a wonderful, wonderful belief of the church and a great comfort to us that we can pray for those who have passed on, because we believe we are all connected. We all make up something that the church calls the communion of saints. Those who are in heaven, those who are in purgatory, and all of us here, we're all connected. All of us. Your relatives and friends that have gone before you are with you. You're connected to them. It's a wonderful belief and a comforting belief for all of us, that those who have gone before us are with us, that they accompany us. And here's another wonderful Catholic belief, that they pray for us. The definition of a saint is anyone who has made it to heaven. Sometimes people say, well, why do you Catholics pray or ask the saints to pray for you. You know, we only pray to God, right? God is the only one who answers our prayers. Right? We say, Lord, hear our prayers. But when we talk about the saints, what do we say? We say, pray for us. That's why when we pray the Hail Mary, we say, Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us. We don't say, hear our prayers, because Mary and all the other saints take our prayers and bring them to God. That's what we believe. Just and if you ask people who are Protestant, and I use the word Protestant, I don't use Christian, because sometimes there's that confusion when some say, you all are Catholics and we are Christians. No, we're Christians. And sometimes Protestants will say, well, why do you pray asking for the saints to pray for you? Well, I say, well, can't I ask you to pray for me? Can't I ask you to pray for me? Oh, of course, I'm a believer. Well, what's the difference? If I can ask you to pray for me, why can't I ask those who are already in heaven to pray for me? That's all we do as Catholics. We ask the saints, those who have made it already to heaven, to pray for us. What a comforting belief. That's all we do. We ask them to pray for us. And so your relatives and friends, and we all have people very close to us who have passed on. And if you believe that they are in heaven, you have a saint in heaven that can pray for you. Ask them for their prayers. As we ask Mary, as we ask Joseph, as we ask all the other saints of the church to pray for us. Our Catholic faith is so rich. All we have to do is discover the richness of our traditions and be excited about our faith. Be excited about the richness of our faith, the great comfort that comes in our life from the faith of the church. What a comfort the Lord has given us in our Catholic faith. And so let's look at this first reading from the Book of Wisdom. I gave you notes there if you want to look at them, the notes for this coming Sunday. The author of wisdom was able to recognize that wisdom is greater than possessions. The author of this book presents King Solomon contemplating the human condition and praising the gift of wisdom. Wisdom, the Bible teaches us, and the author here teaches us, is more precious than silver or gold. Again, this is very important to understanding this particular reading. Wisdom is more precious than silver or gold. And wisdom in the Bible is personified. If you're reading the Old Testament, you will see wisdom being personified. To possess wisdom is to possess someone, not something. Sophia is the name for wisdom in Greek. So wisdom, in biblical terms, refers to God. God is wisdom. To have wisdom is to have God. And Jesus Christ is God. So when we've got God in us. Remember, the Bible teaches us it's not I who live, but Christ who lives in me and through me. We've got wisdom in us. God is in us. And in the gospel that we will just hear in a little bit, Jesus teaches us that following him is greater than possessions. Such is the way of wisdom. Such is the way of God. You see, all of these readings, the church, in her wisdom, chooses for us each Sunday and puts them together, and they work together to transmit for us a beautiful message of hope. A meaningful message for our life. Now, the song that we will hear is Psalm 90. Okay? And let's read this beautiful song together. Repeat after me. Fill us with your love, O Lord, and we will sing for joy together. Fill us with your love, O Lord, and we will sing for joy. Teach us to number our days aright, that we may gain wisdom of heart. Return, O Lord, how long? Have pity on your servants. Fill us with your love, O Lord, and we will sing for joy.
Fill us at daybreak with your kindness, that we may shout for joy and gladness all our days. Make us glad for the days when you afflicted us, for the years when we sought evil. Fill us with your love, O Lord, and we will sing for joy. Let your work be seen by your servants, and your glory by your children. And may the gracious care of the Lord our God be ours. Prosper the work of our hands for us. Prosper the work of our hands. Fill us with your love, O Lord, and we will sing for joy. And as the first stanza of this psalm, there's 150 psalms in the Bible, those beautiful prayers that come to inspire us. As the first stanza shows, it is influenced by wisdom theology. Asking what? That we may get a heart of wisdom. A heart of wisdom. Teach us to number our days aright, that we may gain wisdom of heart. God in us, to understand his ways. And the ways, as the first reading proclaimed, that wisdom is more precious than silver or gold. In other words, having Jesus, having God in your life, is more precious than having any material possessions. And now the letter to the Hebrews, okay? Chapter 4. Brothers and sisters, indeed the word of God is living and effective, sharper than any two-edged sword, penetrating even between soul and spirit, joints and marrow, and able to discern reflections and thoughts of the heart. No creature is concealed from him, but everything is naked and exposed to the eyes of him to whom we must render an account. The word of the Lord. Whereas in the Old Testament, the word of God was primarily God's word announced by the prophets, the word of God in the New Testament is the gospel message, right? When we hear the word of God. And Jesus is the word of God, right? Jesus is the gospel. Jesus is the good news. You see what Hebrews is trying to announce to us? The people to whom Hebrews is addressed are drifting away from the gospel through boredom and stagnation. As sometimes happens in the life of all of us. We feel bored in our walk with the Lord. Is this how it's going to be? They are drifting away from the Word. In other words, they are drifting away from Jesus. When the Bible talks about the Word is Jesus. He is the Word. They are warned here in this letter that the gospel is not something to be played with. Failure to persevere in faith and to develop toward maturity incurs just as sharp a judgment as willful rejection of the gospel in the first place. In other words, those of us who have already been exposed to the Word of God have a great responsibility put on us. The fact that we are baptized, we are Christians, that we go to church, doesn't make us any more special than anybody else in the eyes of God. We are not better because we are baptized. We are not better because we are Christians. We are not better because we are Catholics. What we have is more responsibility to practice our faith, to put into action that which we have received, to live out our faith. That's what this letter is trying to tell us. That if you reject the gospel with the way you live, once you have heard it, it's just as bad as if you rejected it outright from the beginning. You see how much responsibility is placed on us to be more loving, more merciful, more kinder to one another, to reflect Jesus more, to live as though wisdom, Jesus, the word is more precious than silver or gold. It's a great responsibility. In other words, the need for change in the life of the believer is constant. Every day I gotta get up and pray to change. Lord, give me the grace to change. It's a constant metanoia. It's not, metanoia is the Greek word that I told you last week, the total turnaround of our lives. It's not that I accept Jesus as my Lord and Savior, confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord, and boom, I'm done. I'm a finished product. It doesn't work that way. It's a constant struggle. Constant struggle. Every single day, I get up and I work harder and harder to change, to rid my life of that which is not letting me be the follower that Jesus is calling me to be in this life. And that's where the gospel comes in today. The gospel of Mark that we will hear next Sunday. Chapter 10, verses 17 through 30. Please listen to these beautiful words. As Jesus was setting out on a journey, a man ran up to him, knelt down before him and asked him, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus answered him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good but God alone. You know the commandments. You shall not kill. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness. You shall not defraud. Honor your father and your mother." He replied and said to him, "Teacher, all of these I have observed from my youth." Jesus, looking at him, loved him and said to him, "You are lacking in one thing. Go sell what you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me." At that statement, his face fell, and he went away sad, for he had many possessions. Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, "How hard it is for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom of God." The disciples were amazed at his words. So Jesus again said to them in reply, "Children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to pass through the eye of a needle than for one who is rich to enter the kingdom of God." They were exceedingly astonished and said among themselves, "Then who can be saved?" Jesus looked at them and said, "For human beings it is impossible, but not for God. All things are possible for God." Peter began to say to him, "We have given up everything and followed you." Jesus said, "Amen, I say to you, there is no one who has given up house or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or lands for my sake and for the sake of the gospel who will not receive 100 times more now in this present age, houses and brothers and sisters and mothers and children and lands with persecutions, and eternal life in the age to come." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
This story that we have just heard is present in all three synoptic Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. These three Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, are synoptic, as we call them, because they have many similarities. That is to say, many of the same stories appear in all three Gospel accounts. John is different, as there are many stories in the Gospel of John that do not appear in the synoptic Gospels. Scholars tell us that Matthew, Mark, and Luke probably had a common source known as Q that they drew upon in order to write their gospel accounts. That's why there's so many similarities in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. John, on the other hand, was on his own. And also John wrote much later than the other three gospels known as synoptics. We believe John wrote between the year 90 to 100. And the early church gave a cutoff date for anything making it into the New Testament. So anything that was written after the year 100 did not make it into the canon of the New Testament. Mark is the only one who suggests here this story that this man that we have just heard about is rich. So we only hear in Mark that this man is rich. Matthew is the only one who says he is young. That's why you've heard about the rich young man, okay? And Luke is the only one who calls him a ruler. So people say the rich young ruler, okay? And so, you see how the Gospels go together? Mark here suggests that this man is rich because he's not concerned with questions like, where can I find a job, right? He comes to Jesus with a question. Right? What is the question? How can I inherit eternal life? Right? He doesn't have the questions of a poor person, right? Like, how can I find a job? How can I feed my family? His questions are the rich man's questions. Now, you have to understand something. Wealth, during the time of Jesus, was a sign of God's blessing. It gave you the assurance that you were in God's favor. You were all right in the sight of God if you were wealthy, if you were rich. If wealth, on the other hand, if wealth was attained through lies, such as was the case of tax collectors, then it was like poison for those who had it. You did not enjoy the favor of God. This is why tax collectors were considered to be among the worst of sinners, as they are presented in the Bible. Tax collectors during the time of Jesus would be Jews who turned and became traitors for the enemy. Remember, the Jewish people were occupied by the Roman Empire. And so tax collectors were Jews who worked on behalf of the Roman government. And they would extort money from regular people. They would go from house to house and tax the people. Extort money from them. And usually the way that these tax collectors would get rich is they would hand over only part of the money that they collected and part of the money they kept for themselves. Now you see why they were so despised? And so if you became rich the right way, without lying, without cheating, that's God's blessing according to those times. If you became rich by lying, by cheating, by extorting, then you were despised. So, this rich young ruler comes to Jesus. Something is missing from his life, right? Otherwise, he wouldn't come to Jesus with a question. The fact that this man comes to Jesus, asking him, "What must I do to inherit eternal life?" means that the man knows something is missing from his life. In other words, he's saying, "What must I do? What must I do? Tell me, Jesus, what must I do?" This man, in effect, goes to confession here. He goes to confession. Something we all need to do. He says, "I have kept the law all my life, which is how I know it is not enough. I have amassed great wealth, which is how I know that it is not enough either. I am a rich man, rich in things, rich in respectability, and rich in obedience to the law. That is how I know none of those things is enough to give me the life I want." And that's how he's asking, "What must I do to inherit eternal life?" And when he asks this question, what does the Bible tell us? Jesus looks at him and he loves him, the Bible says. Isn't that the most beautiful line there? Jesus looks at this rich young ruler and the Bible says he loves him. What happens when we go to confession? God looks at us with great love, open arms. Come to me, right? All you who find life burdensome, and I will give you rest, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Come to me, for I love you. In the same way that Jesus loved this rich young ruler, he loves each and every one of us. When we are sincere, when we are sincere, as this rich young man was, he was sincere. He was ready for God. His heart was right to receive God in his life. He has come to the end of what society can do for him. He has come to the end of what his church can do for him. All that is left for him to do is to come and kneel at the feet of Jesus. You see, what does the Bible say? This rich young man comes to Jesus and he kneels before him. He kneels before him. What do we do when we go to confession? When we enter the confessional box? We kneel, don't we? We kneel before Jesus. We have come to the end of all that anyone else can do for us, all that the world can do for us, all that the church can do for us, right? All that anyone else can do for us. We come to Jesus, asking him, Lord, help me. Help me. Give me the answer to my problems. And Jesus shows him great compassion and great understanding. Jesus loves what he sees in this young man, a true seeker. Jesus sees someone who is genuinely trying to keep God's commandments, as all of us are. We're all trying to keep God's commandments. That's why we're here, right? We know what those commandments are. Just like all of us, this man knows that there is more to life, which is why he comes to Jesus with the question. We know that too. We know there's more to life. We know there's more to life than our possessions. We know there's more to life than our wealth, than the things we can get. We know there's more to life than what meets our eye. We know there's more to life than all that is around us. That's why we're here. We know that. That's why we come to Jesus. And just like Peter, this young man exclaims in his heart, which is the exclamation that has to happen in each of our lives. To whom shall we go? To whom? To whom shall we go, O Lord? To whom shall we go? You have the words of everlasting life. What must I do to inherit eternal life? In other words, when we go to Jesus in confession, with sincere hearts that are seeking, Jesus in like manner looks at us and loves us. And so do not be afraid to go to Jesus and open up your heart to him with the questions that are burning up inside of your heart. He's there for you. This man shows great humility, doesn't he? Unlike the people who say they have no sin, no need for confession, no need for change. There's lots of people like that all around who come and say, I have no sin. When people come to me and say, you talk about going to confession. I don't have any sins. And you know what I tell them? Well, let's take the statue of Mary down and put you up there. Since you have no sins. We have to come to Jesus as this rich young man did, with great humility. We all know that there is more than the miserable life that we have been leading, right? With all the problems. And just like this man in the gospel, we too must come to Jesus, kneel before him, and beg him to give us the grace to change. The grace to change, to become new people, to experience a total metanoia, total conversion, new outlook on life, a new attitude. That's what we need. But just like in the life of this man, when Jesus looks inside of us and makes a diagnosis of what it is that we lack, we turn away and walk away because of our unwillingness to give up that which is keeping us away from leading the life Jesus has come to give us. We don't want to make the changes necessary. Oh no. We prefer to lead the life that we have been leading. So we walk away, sad, depressed, as this young man did in the gospel. Some of us might be like this young man in the gospel today, all excited because we have found Jesus. A lot of us are, you know, a lot of people are, they're so excited because they have found Jesus. Jesus who has the words of everlasting life. We have found the man who can tell us, who can diagnose us, who can tell us what it is that is wrong with us. But just like the man in the gospel today, when we hear what it is that we need to do in order to be healed, what do? We walk away. We don't want to make the changes. We don't want to give up that which is keeping us away from the life that Jesus wants us to lead. We prefer to walk away rather than to make the necessary changes that are required of a follower of Jesus. This young man missed his opportunity to become the 13th apostle. He missed his opportunity. Don't miss yours. Don't miss yours. The invitation is there. As we heard last week, or the week before, right? If your hand causes you to sin, cut it off. If your foot causes you to sin, cut it off. If your eye causes you to sin, pluck it out. In other words, get rid of your life, all that is not leading you in the right path. We know all that we have to do. And yet, as the Bible tells us, we would prefer to eat our own vomit like dogs. That's right. The Bible says we are like dogs who go back to eat their own vomit. That's why we go back. You know, people, for example, who get drunk, right? And they, in the morning, they wake up with a hangover, right? And they feel all terrible, they're all sick, they load themselves up with Tylenol or whatever to loosen up their blood, and they feel all terrible. Come next weekend, you see them getting drunk again. Oh yeah. People who've lost thousands of dollars in the casino, right? I'm never going to go back and play ever again! Right? What happens? You see them next weekend. Over the machine, feeding hundreds into it. I'm going to win! Right? You see how right the Bible is? The Bible tells us we are like a dog who returns to eat his own vomit. And people like that, the Bible says, are fools who repeat their foolishness. This is in Proverbs 26:11. In other words, the second letter of Peter tells us, many of us are like a washed pig who returns to the mud. You ever, I grew up in Poland on a farm. When you wash the pig, it would go back into the mud, right? This is harsh language, but this is reality, right? I tell you all of these things because I love you. That's why, you know? And my responsibility is to present to you the Word of God. If there is no change in our life, then we're not following Jesus the right way. And change only happens in our life when there is challenge in our life. No challenge equals no change. If the gospel is not challenging you, then there is something wrong. The gospel comes to challenge us. To change us. Didn't you hear that in the second reading today? The Word of God is like a two-edged sword, living and effective. It comes and penetrates our heart so that we may have a total change of attitude, a new outlook on life, a new way of living. Jesus is giving this rich young ruler an invitation, and he is giving it to all of us to become new creatures. Defined in a new way, to trade in all the words that have described us up to now. What are the words that describe you in your life? Wealthy, committed, culture responsible, powerful, obedient. You are to train all of these words in on a radically new word. You know what that word is? Free. Free. That's what you describe you as a follower of Jesus. Free. I am free. That's the word that describes a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ. Free. That's what he came to give us. Freedom. Not wealth, not possessions. Freedom. Freedom. Jesus has come to set us free. And so, this particular gospel passage asks us, are you enslaved by the things that surround you, by your possessions, maybe by the people in your life? This is not a matter of belief or faith. This is a matter of doing. Anybody can say, I believe and I have faith. But it's another issue to change, right? We all can say, I believe, you know, with our lips and all that. It's another issue to change, to make the necessary changes in our life, to do that which is necessary in order to be free, to experience the freedom that Jesus came to give us. Faith and works, they go together, as the book of James tells us. Faith and works. Jesus doesn't tell this man, you must believe and confess with your lips that I am your Lord, and boom, you're going to be a new creature. No, Jesus plainly says, do this, and you will be free. Do this. None of us can earn eternal life. The kingdom of God is not for sale. The poor cannot buy it with their poverty any more than the rich can buy it with their riches. The poor do not have an upper hand in all of this. Neither do the rich. It's offered to all. Poor or free. Just because you have wealth doesn't mean it's a curse in your life. Just gives you more chances to share that wealth, to be a more giving person, a better follower of Jesus. There's nothing wrong with having wealth if you're free in the midst of your wealth. The kingdom of God is free, but you have to be free in order to receive it. You've got to be free in order to receive the kingdom of God. It is a grace, a gift. Faith is a gift. But you have to be free of all that is enslaving you all around you in order to receive it. You cannot accept God's gift if you have no spare hands to take it with. If it's all about all the things in your life, you can't accept God's gift. You cannot make room for it if all your rooms are already full. You cannot follow if you are not free to go. That's a powerful thing. You cannot follow if you are not free to go. If something is pulling you back. That's why Jesus says today, when Peter says, we have left everything. Our jobs, our lands, everything in order to follow you. Our families. And Jesus says, no one who has left behind their families, their friends, their jobs, their possessions will not receive 100 times more. In other words, be free. You have to be free. The rich young ruler understood that his riches did not make him free, and that is why he went away sad, sorrowful. It's all about the attitude in our life. I remember when the crash was happening. Remember the housing crash? I met two women who were both losing homes. And one of them I met and my heart went out. And she says, Father, we're losing our home. It's being foreclosed upon. We're going to have to move into an apartment, put our things in storage. How devastating. How am I going to make it in a two-bedroom apartment when I've been in a house? And I felt so bad for her. My heart went out. And the same day I met another lady who did the same thing. She says, Father, we're losing our home. We're going to have to move into an apartment. And I said, oh, you must be devastated. I'm so sorry for you and Jesus. Father, who cares about the fact that I'm losing my home and that I'll have to live in an apartment? Who cares about the mansion I have here on earth when God has a mansion prepared for me in heaven? That is the attitude of a believer, somebody who's free, somebody whose things haven't had possession of them, haven't taken possession of their life. They're not enslaved. What about you? Are you enslaved by the things in your life, by the people in your life, by your possessions, or are you free? That's the freedom God gives. This rich young man went away sad. He went away sorrowful because his things enslaved him. He was not free. We can all be free in the midst of whatever it is that we're going through, in the midst of anything. I was a volunteer chaplain at Pelican Bay State Prison. I met prisoners there who were in prison for life. No chance of parole, but they were free. Free because they met Jesus. He gave them their freedom. He freed them, and I know lots of people, wealthy people, people who have all the things in the world, people who have their health, people who have everything, powerful jobs, but they are enslaved. They are not happy. How many people commit suicide today? Things do not give us happiness. Only God makes man happy. That's clear in the Bible. Only God. No one else and nothing else can make you happy. Only God. He is the source of our happiness. God alone can make us free and make us happy. Amen. Do you know that this rich young ruler is the only person in the whole gospel who walks away from an invitation to follow Jesus? He is the only wounded one who declines to be healed. Poverty scared him more than bondage. He could not believe that the opposite of rich might not be poor, but free. Jesus, throughout the Gospels, is all about challenging the social order, turning it upside down. Hence, he is turning around the common belief of his day that wealth meant that you were blessed by God. It is not wealth that is the guarantee of blessing. It is freedom. When you're free, you are blessed. Do you know what the word blessed means? It means happiness, joy. When you are free, you are blessed. Blessing means joy and happiness, an interior happiness and joy that we can only experience if we are free. Leaving things behind is not a prerequisite to becoming a disciple of Jesus. It is not a requirement. It is a consequence. It is a consequence that we leave things behind, that they are not important to us anymore, that Jesus is important to us. Serving him, following him. When we become free, when he takes possession of our life, all the other possessions are not when we have Jesus. Once I have experienced the freedom that comes from having a relationship with Jesus, making him the Lord and master of my life, everything else is secondary. I am free. So, you did not choose God. God chose you. You are here because God has chosen you, because God loves you. Look at the apostles when Jesus called them. The Bible doesn't say that Jesus said, leave everything behind. The Bible says they left everything behind. It's a consequence. It was their choice. It is your choice whether you will respond to the invitation. God has chosen you. He has you here because he loves you. They left their nets. They left their boats. They left their relatives. They left their lucrative careers. Not because they had to, but because they wanted to. They wanted to. They wanted to follow Jesus. He called and nothing else seemed all that important anymore. He set them free, not because of their achievements, but because he gave them the gift, the grace, because he loved them. because he chose them. It is likewise with us. God chose us, not us. We did not choose God. Did God go after Mary in the Bible? Of course he did. She didn't go after him. God went after her. God went after Joseph and all the prophets, after Abraham, after Moses, and God's after all of us because God loves us. That's the most important. Now, how can all of this happen? How can we respond by changing, by converting? Alone, we can't do it, as we've heard in the gospel today. Alone, you can't do it. With your own strength, you can't do it. But with God, all things are possible, as we heard today. All things are possible for God. You can change. You can. You can become a new creature. You can become free, as we pray. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Lord Jesus, we thank you for this time today that we have looked at your word. We thank you for the gift of your word. We praise you. And we declare you to be the Lord and Master of our lives. The only Lord and Master of our lives. The only King of our lives. The ruler of our lives. That nothing else is more important to us than you, O Lord. Nothing else is as important as having a relationship with you. For you are the only guarantor of our freedom. The freedom that you came to give us. The freedom that sets us free. That makes us your children. We thank you for this gift as we glorify your name now and always, saying, glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end.
Amen.
And may the Lord be with you.
And
may Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace.